I want to welcome you to this extraordinary conversation from Tiananmen Square to the Arab Spring, from Sarajevo to South Africa and far beyond. CNN has delivered the world's influential events to viewers around the globe. But in an industry, though, that is traditionally occupied by men, you are about to hear from female photojournalists that were on the front lines of history, taking pictures in some of the most dangerous events that we have ever witnessed in our lifetimes. The CNN film, No Ordinary Life, celebrates courageous female photojournalists who were trailblazers in the industry, who captured history. Let's start by talking and looking at the work of the extraordinary women behind the film, No Ordinary Life.
Being a camera woman is a tough job. We were combat camera women.
We were sent out on these stories. They were very dangerous.
You're it. You're the one that's going to see it, and you're the one that's going to record it. Among that horror, every shot had to mean something.
The camera women who brought the front lines to the headlines.
We'd come back with the goods.
No Ordinary Life, Monday, September 5th at 10, only on CNN.
It is truly breathtaking. All of the photography, all of the sound, it is fantastic. And it is fantastic because it was taken by these incredible women and directed also by a woman. The director and photojournalist Heather O'Neill is with us. Maria Fleet, Emmy award-winning journalist, and Cynde Strande, award-winning journalist as well. Thank you, ladies, for being here.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right. I'm going to start with you, Cynde. So I have to tell the backstory that I know I've worked with Cynde and Maria, both. Cynde has barked down the phone at me more than once and given me very good advice and maybe heard me, you know, tear up a few times as well. But you have covered everything from Tiananmen Square protest, the first Gulf War, the first free democratic election in South Africa, Rwandan genocide, Burma, the war in Bosnia. When you start listing these different things, two things come to mind. One, the danger, and two, the beauty of the shots that you were able to take in that danger. Can you give us a sense of how you do that, how you divorce yourself from the danger and you're still able to get these gorgeous pictures?
Well, as a camera person, it's so easy to just disappear into your eyepiece and you almost block out what's around you and you just focus in, and often, you know, focus in on people, their faces, what's happening to them. But at the same time, you know, you do have to stay aware of what's around you because situations can change on a dime and a friendly crowd might turn into a violent crowd. So you're really living in multiple layers, you know, you're focusing in on that lens to get the best shot possible. You are aware of what's around you, and you have to be aware of your safety. And ultimately, you know that you're the one you're on the front line, or you're in a place no one else is, and you're the one that's going to bring back perhaps proof of a war crime or a story that no one else could get to. And it's really important to document these events.
Maria, I will go down the list of things that you have done. I think people just need to know where you have been. You started, I think CNN started in June of 1980. You started in 1981. And from that moment on, it was like history event after event after event. The fall of the Berlin Wall, you were there for that. The Gulf War, the dissolution of Yugoslavia, Somalia, the Chechen and Kosovo wars, the US invasion of Iraq after 9/11. There are so many things coming at you. And I noticed you said something in there that would resonate with anyone who's ever been in a conflict. You said you get to leave and go back to your nice life. How have you dealt with that?
You know, that it's hard sometimes. I mean, you witness so much trauma and so many dramatic events that are happening, and you're capturing what is happening to people as they're uprooted in their lives because of war and other types of conflicts. And you carry with yourself a little bit of guilt, because yes, you leave them after your assignment is over. You've been there maybe for 2 weeks getting to know people, and then you go back to your life. And it's almost like a weird bit of, maybe you could call it survivor guilt or something like that. But I always try to reassure myself in some sense that my camera, my eye on that story was what I was offering to the people. And that was what I had to give them. I always felt like I wanted to do more, but what I feel like what we did do as camera women was to expose and dramatize and to document and witness for the world these events.
Heather O'Neill, you are the director, a photojournalist yourself. And you know, so often, you know, you never hear from the photographers because they're the ones behind the camera taking the pictures. And so often they don't want to go in front of the camera. But you captured the true essence of each of these women, having known a few of them. You really captured that. Why was it important for you to tell this story?
You know, honestly, when I started at CNN, I hadn't met a camera woman yet, not until I went to Baghdad in 2006 and met Mary Rogers. And honestly, Sarah, I was just really blown away by her. She was just this fierce, you know, dedicated professional. And, you know, she just went all over the world. And I as I got to sort of, you know, grow at CNN in my role, I knew that this was an important story that I wanted to tell, because I don't always think we think about who is behind the camera. And, you know, I began to learn that it was not only Mary, but there was Margaret Moth and Cynde and Maria and Jane. And it was just such a great story. And I wanted to immerse people in the experience of being behind the camera, what they were seeing, what they were going through, you know, those split second decisions you have to make and those really, you know, tricky, hairy situations. And, you know, just honestly, their body of work for decades. I mean, they really did, as you said, truly captured history. And I just felt that this was a powerful story that had to be told.
I have to ask you, Heather, why the hell hasn't someone done this before? These women have been doing this, like you said, for decades. And it's incredible to me. Here we are in a world where everyone's got a phone and everyone, you know, sort of knows a lot of everyone else's story within this company. And yet, here we are in 2022 telling this story about women who've been doing this for 20, 30, dare I say 40 years.
Yeah, right. Yeah, Mary. I don't know. It's amazing. You know, to be fair, CNN did do a documentary on Margaret Moth years ago, and it was excellent. You know, but I really was, you know, informed by that. I never got to meet Margaret, but hearing, you know, talking to Cynde and other photojournalists at CNN and her friend Joe Duran, I really sort of got an essence of her. But yeah, I mean, it's a great story. And I was, you know, kind of pleasantly surprised that nobody else was in the works on this. And, you know, I approached all of these women and I knew some, of course, they were friends, our friends, and we made it happen. So yeah, we're really excited.
Cynde, was there any specific moment that happened or that you reflected on and said, you know what, I'm done out here? Because you ended up, you know, having a long career after leaving the field, the full-time, you know, full-time in the field, covering everything from, you know, wars to famine. Was there something that just made you decide that, you know what, I want to do something else now?
So, you know, I had exactly the life I wanted to have, and it was incredible. The going around the world, witnessing, I mean, in the front row of history and meeting incredible people and working with incredible people. And then, you know, I started to get older and I realized, oh my goodness, my life is always someone else's life, be it the, you know, the war victim or the natural disaster victim. And I had a child late in life, and, you know, watching and seeing so many children, so many years in such bad and desperate and sad situations, you know, I woke up one day and I said, gosh, you know, I was lucky enough to have a child late in life. I don't want to miss anything. So I called my boss at the time and she just started laughing and she said, Cynde, I really expected this call a year ago. And it's amazing. So many women today can balance both. And so many women at CNN, I just admire them so much because they can balance their home life and their life in the field. But for me, I was at a massacre site in the Ivory Coast and it was very gruesome. And I wasn't going to get home for Mom and Tot's singing group on Tuesday. And something in my mind just turned. And the realization is I need to be there for my child. I was lucky enough to have one late in life. And I just didn't want to miss anything.
Beautifully said. Maria, are there any images? Because I know the images often stay with all of us, those of us who are viewers, those of us who are on the ground. Are there any images that you've captured that are stuck in your head that you sometimes refer back to?
Yes, very much so. We're, as camera women, we're visual people, and those images do kind of remain frozen sometimes in our minds, kind of filtering through our memories. And one in particular that has always been in my mind is a man that came across the border into Albania from Kosovo after NATO airstrikes that were meant to punish Slobodan Milosevic and the Yugoslav army who were conducting ethnic cleansing in Kosovo. And he came across with these bandaged hands, these giant white, they looked like boxing gloves, these, you know, white bandaged hands. And those were the most prominent features of this very tall man. And he told us that he had been barely escaped being burned alive. He was thrown into a house, gathered up with other men and thrown into a house and shot, the Serb police shot at them. And he escaped by actually falling and pretending to be shot when the bullets flew. And he escaped. He managed to escape when they when Serbs went to, they set it on fire and they went back to get more fuel. And he took his chance and escaped. And he said in witness testimony at The Hague, he was witness to a war crime, obviously. And he said, you know, he just took a chance to flee because he'd rather be shot than be burned alive. So he ran across the border and we encountered him.
It's chilling.
It's one of those images that stays with me.
And the story of him, you know, the story of somebody that you have a brief encounter with, but they impact your life forever. It is,
right.
It's harrowing. Right? It's harrowing.
Right. And I'm
getting these images.
I actually wondered about him recently and in writing something about that incident and was able to find him and contact him. And he is back in Kosovo on his farm with his family. And it was strangely, you know, a very personal kind of resolution for me in my mind to know that he was back there. And
I know you all three, all three of you can attest to like the happy endings don't always happen, especially in what you do. And so that is such a wonderful ending to a story that you just, sometimes you never know. Heather, you went through, I can't imagine how much archival footage you had to go through and cut. One of the, you know, in the trailer and in the film as well, there is this scene of hearing Mary Rogers, a photographer, running and screaming as they're being shot at because the car seems like it's going to leave her. And I know Mary very well, and she is a hilarious human being. Like, the woman never stops. But to hear that guttural scream, to hear that desperation in her, which you rarely hear, she's usually barking at you to tell you where to go and what to do. How did you decide what to put in and what to cut out? Because there's a ton of stuff that these women have taken pictures of and filmed.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not a photojournalist, just to be clear. I'm the director of the film. But, you know, hundreds of hours. It's amazing. I mean, this film honestly wouldn't have been made without their archive. I mean, it was just astounding. And it took, you know, a good probably 10 months to go through the footage. It was really incredible. But, you know, as Cynde says, it was a front row to history. I mean, I learned so much personally just going through their footage and seeing just the incredible stories they captured too, because, you know, they were also producers and putting stories together and, you know, had this whole just body of work that was amazing. So incredibly lucky. My producer, Rich Brooks, former CNN as well, also was by my side going through the footage and it was great. I mean, it was tough. There were a lot of stories we were not able to put into the film and that was hard, you know.
I love that you included Margaret Moth. I never got to work with her either, but her story is so incredible. And hearing from other people like Christian and Ingrid Formanek, two well-known names in this industry and in the world, it was beautiful the way that you put all of those together with all of the stories. I wanted to ask you, Maria, at the beginning of the film, this all sort of begins with you all telling, you know, the dreams that you had before you started and how you ended up in this place at the forefront of history. Maria, what was your dream?
I kind of always wanted to travel. I was always interested in other cultures, and you know, I that was something that was very interesting to me. But I wasn't really sure what would take me, you know, somewhere. I actually liked to write, and that was what got me into journalism to begin with. And when I graduated from college, CNN was just starting out, and so it seemed like the most obvious place to try and work. I mean, nobody knew what it was. This CNN, what is this? 24-hour news. It was such a, you know, it was a new concept. I mean, it was a concept that people told Ted Turner wouldn't even work. But initially, I was an editor and a videotape editor, and they asked us as editors if we wanted to go out and work with the camera people, you know, do a little rotation in the field, and with the camera people. And so I was the first person that got to do that. And I went out, and once I got outside the building, I had been working in the studio. And when I got outside the building, I was like, I'm never going back inside that building again. This is where it's all happening.
That is a 100% true story, but there's a lot of work being done back here, but there is a certain, excitement and travel that is unmatched. Cynde, you were in Tiananmen Square, and you know, it blows my mind to think about that, because those pictures are so iconic. They spoke so much about what was happening. How did you end up being a photographer at Tiananmen Square at that time, that night?
Oh my gosh. Well, believe it or not, my story, I mean, I studied engineering for the first 3 years of my college studies, and I was fortunate enough to realize, oh my gosh, you know, my real love in life is photography. And so during my time at CNN, you know, to go internationally, you often would quit and move there and then hope to be hired. But how I ended up in China is I loved to study Chinese, and I quit CNN for a year and moved to China and studied Chinese for a year. Again, a calculated risk. My life is a series of calculated risk. So I was studying Chinese for a year right at the time that they were going to open their first bureau in Beijing. So they took a chance on me. I mean, CNN was incredible. They didn't really see if it wasn't, are you a woman or a man? Or they just took a chance on us, and you know, the gender wasn't really an issue. And so that's how I ended up in China when CNN first opened the Beijing bureau. And then, of course, that night, you know, as any camera person would do, we knew it was going to happen, and I gathered my small team together. It was happening overnight. And of course, anyone that wants to leave, you tell them to go now because you are probably going to be stuck here all night. And, you know, no shame, those that want to go, go. And actually, you know, to stay safe, at one point we ended up hiding in a bathroom in the square. And, you know, we were, you know, one of the few teams that stayed all night in the square and saw what happened. You know, the massacre didn't happen in the square, it happened around the square. And that's so important. If we hadn't been there, the story would have been reported inaccurately. And we saw the students leave and they were beaten off the square and we were able to interview them. And then we had to hide on a rickshaw and hide our tape and get it back to headquarters. But, you know, once again, the importance of being there.
It's so good because we all have this one image of what happened and you all made sure we knew what happened outside of our direct view where the tank, you know, tank sort of stops in front of a human being. Heather, as a director, did you make a concerted effort to show this? I think sisterhood is probably the best way to put it, because there were a lot of women in the field that usually you didn't see at that time. There just happened to be this group.
Yeah, I mean, it really struck me, you know, even just talking to them when we were initially thinking about doing this film, just how close they were. I mean, they were really good friends. And I think they can all attest to the fact that, you know, back in the 80s and, you know, early 90s, I mean, Cynde said it best. I mean, you know, people didn't talk about PTSD. And I think, you know, I saw a bond that had been forged through a lot of, you know, difficult work and difficult assignments. And I know from what they all shared with me that you know, they talked to each other. You know, they really did form this strong sisterhood. And it was very clear in the beginning, and like a really wonderful thing to discover as a director, that, you know, this is an enduring sisterhood. And, you know, we brought them together a few summers ago to all, you know, sort of hang out one night. And it was like they had never stopped talking. And, you know, I'm walking away and I'm hearing them laughing and telling stories. And it was just really nice. And I think, you know, that bond was forged in tough places. And it's just really nice to see how much they supported each other, because as women, it's important to support each other. And it was really nice themed to be able to include in the film.
You did that alongside this hard charging, no bullshit taking, like frontline staying scenario. And you did let the story of Margaret Moth, and I just want to come back to that, really play out, and those who were around her talk about how fierce she was. But she was shot in Bosnia-Herzegovina in Sniper Alley. And why was it so important for you to say, listen, you know, this person can't right now speak for herself, but her work did?
Yeah, I mean, that was one of the things I struggled with early on. Is Margaret passed away before we made the film, so I really didn't have a lot of footage of her, and Margaret really didn't have a voice in the film, and that was tough. So finding this footage of her, you know, going back to Sarajevo after she had been shot was pretty incredible, because I don't think most people would have made that choice, perhaps. So it was, you know, through her work also, it was nice to be able to pay tribute to her. You know, she was a badass by every account, and somebody who was really solidly professional and, you know, took her work very seriously. And like, you know, as they've all told me, she loved every minute of it. I mean, you know, she wanted to go back to Sarajevo to find her teeth. As a joke, but it was nice to be able to include her in this film and give her due.
It was beautifully done. Maria, you know, as you kind of look back at all the things, do you think about the danger at all? Do you think about what could have happened? And have you experienced, answer if you want to, have you experienced PTSD? Have you experienced the things that come up with that?
Well, I think, you know, I say in the film, I talk about in the film, the fact that there are times when I can't even utter the word refugee without my voice catching, because it was so profound to see people uprooted from their lives and lose all sense of security. And I mean, I get emotional just thinking about that, because we take our security so for granted. So yeah, that is something that I think it does stay with me. I mean, I don't know how it affects me other than, you know, I think I just feel for all the people in the world who don't have security, and it's just so doubly important that we, CNN, our compatriots that are out in the field now, are still putting their lens, their eye on these mm-hmm. situations.
It's really easy to get comfortable. Cynde, there is a war currently going on in Ukraine. And when you see what's happening there, is there ever that itch to go back to it? Or because you are involved, you did get pulled back in a bit, maybe not on the front lines, but you got pulled back in, didn't you?
You know, once a journalist, always a journalist. And you know, I will always have the desire to be there. I mean, that just never, never, never goes away. And, you know, I have to applaud the courageous work of the people that are covering the, you know, the Russian invasion of Bosnia. I mean, Ukraine. And what I was going to say, I mentioned Bosnia, you know, when I started to see those pictures come in of men saying goodbye to their wives and their children, I just get a lump in my throat because I took those same pictures in Bosnia in the early 90s of, you know, men putting their wives and children on these buses and breaking down in tears and not knowing if they're ever going to see them again. And sometimes I just think, oh my God, are we ever going to learn? It's just the same thing again.
And you all put lumps in all of our throats from that video. What was it like watching this? I'll start with you, Maria. What was it like watching the film, looking at some of your work and some of your colleagues' work?
It's, you know, it's hard to watch sometimes. I mean, it's in reviewing it, I think I look at it and think, my God, did we do that? Did we really do that? But it's hard sometimes to watch it because, you know, I mean, you know, in talking about, you know, not the trauma that all the people have gone through that you have witnessed it, you know, it just comes right back to you in this film. And I think it comes across in the pictures that we all took.
What about for you, Cynde?
You know, Sara, I would say, you know, you asked Maria about a picture she remembered, and there's this two sides. And I remember I was in a feeding camp with Christiane Amanpour in Somalia, and we were watching a woman that we had seen in days before die. I mean, we were watching this woman take her last breath. And we didn't know what to do. We couldn't fix it. We couldn't change it. In this day and age, no one should be dying on a mat in the dirt for lack of food. And, you know, to this day, I think, you know, Sara, I didn't know that woman's name. And I carry her with me everywhere. And I just feel so much of what I did for, you know, to tell people's stories. And anywhere I went after that, I always asked people's names. I made sure I knew who these people were. And, you know, something that just affected me so deeply, what I also saw in many places was this incredible goodness and grace in people, in most people. And that, I think, you know, we have all seen that and been lucky to experience that in some of the most horrible conditions, or, you know, ballroom dancing in the townships of South Africa when you just see such grace and beauty. And so I also carry that with me, the balance that in almost all of us is this grace and beauty and giving, the ability to give in the worst situations.
I love that. It's the Mr. Rogers neighborhood, or Mr. Rogers says, you know, look for the helpers, and they're always there. I'm curious from you, Heather, what you wanted to say with this film, because it says a lot of things. What's the ultimate thing you would like people to take away from it?
It's funny. I mean, I get that question so much, and it's a hard one to answer because it's such a multifaceted film. And there are a lot of, you know, different reasons why I wanted to make it. I mean, you know, chiefly it's just, you know, when I was watching Cindy's work in Tiananmen Square, when I was, you know, on summer break in college, I didn't imagine that it was a woman behind the camera. And I remember, you know, my dad like saying, hey, you need to watch this. This is like a really big event going on. And I was, you know, really absorbed in it. And it really had an impact on me. But I only knew later as when I was working at CNN that it was Cindy's work. And, you know, that was part of the thing. I felt like I grew up with CNN as well. And I just didn't simply know that there were these five incredible women behind the camera, you know, bringing history to everyone's, you know, living rooms. So I really think, I mean, that's kind of the takeaway. It's just revealing their work, their incredible work, and everyone has seen it who's watched CNN over the decades. And it's just, it's a great story. And I wanted to share it with everybody.
It's like the best kept secret that most of the world doesn't know that we all knew. It is such a, it's so well done. The shot choices, everything. One of the things that I thought you did so beautiful was the gnat sound, which we reporters tend to talk over, right, Cynde? but you use so much of the natural sound. And I'm assuming that was absolutely purposeful. There wasn't a lot of like, there was nobody tracking, there was nobody sort of telling us but the people who were interviewed.
Yeah, it was. I mean, the gift that all of these, you know, camera women gave us was like a lot of their raw footage. So that was a really wonderful thing, was to be able to look at these stories, you know, beyond the introductions. And, you know, obviously on camera reporters give the story, they deliver the context, and it's critical. We also just wanted to push through a little bit more and bring people into those really intimate moments, you know, of what exactly these women were experiencing and filming, you know, beyond sort of, you know, the headline of what was happening. And it was really a gift again. I mean, there was so much wonderful footage. I would get really excited. Maria would call me up and say, oh, I just found six more boxes of tapes. I'll be over. And I'm like, great. you know, so it was really, it was purposeful because I wanted people to just sort of like, kind of just experience the moment that they were experiencing.
Is there anything about the film for you, Maria, that makes you cringe or, you know, besides the story itself, like listening to yourself? This isn't something you guys do all the time.
Is there anything, I'm sorry, I didn't hear the last.
Anything that impacts you, that sort of makes you either cringe or like say, oh my God, that was so wonderful while you're watching this, because you're seeing yourself in a different light.
I know, it's true. I mean, actually, you know, I when I'm watching the interview of myself, when I get choked up, I get a lump in my throat. I'm like an audience member getting a lump in my throat about my own interview. But that must mean that it's a very effective film, Heather.
I tend to agree. Cynde, what about you? What is it like viewing yourself in a different scenario, different light?
Well, you know, it's a hard watch because, you know, we witnessed so many things, but you know, I will say when I watch that film, I think, you know, not bad for a gal that got a D in the history of journalism class.
Mind blown. This has been such a wonderful conversation, but I will lastly ask if there is anything that I missed, which there's a thousand things, but anything that either of you would like to impart to those watching?
Well, you know, I would say for me, if you in your career or life feel that you are in any way other or different or not a part of the mainstream, that, you know, the world needs the other, and the world needs different. And if you want to pursue a career or a dream or some form of art, just do it. Don't, you know, don't let your own, don't talk yourself out of something, talk yourself into something.
I think that I also think that's very important. Those perspectives, you know, your perspective everyone's perspective is unique. Nobody has the same set of experiences that any individual has. And so they bring, all people bring a unique perspective to any story or any situation. So I echo what Cynde is saying. It's very important to hear all voices.
And that's what made this film so rich too. You know, the other thing I hope and is that, you know, this film would, you know, maybe open a door for a woman who's considering picking up a camera. You know, it still is fairly traditional male dominated. I mean, there's a lot of wonderful female still photographers out there, and there's been a great history and generations of, you know, still photographers. But, you know, it's still, I think it can be a little daunting. And I hope that, you know, someone might see this and say, hey, you know, that might be something that I want to do and maybe hadn't considered it before. So, you know, it's the old adage, you can't be it if you don't see it, right? So I hope that this, you know, might spark someone's imagination, you know.
I have to tell you three, that seeing Jane Evans and Maria Fleet and Margaret Moth and Mary Rogers and you, Cynde Strande, like seeing you all do what you did and what you created, it actually reinvigorates those of us who are still doing it, who are still in this crazy business. It really does have an impact, not just for those that are up and coming, but for those who are, you know, old and withered. it is beautifully done and wonderfully directed, Heather. So thank you all for putting this out there. Just giving
thank
it
you,
to
Sarah.
Us. We need it.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us on this special CNN Keep Watching conversation. No Ordinary Life will premiere on Monday, September 5th at 10 p.m. Eastern. And that is only on CNN.